Hello everyone. In today's lecture, we will solve one numerical on flip-flops and considering the propagation delays. So for an example, in the given circuit here, the components which I used in the sequential circuit, so you can specifically see that flip-flop has the propagation delays, right? Setup times and hold times, correct? So here TPD is called a propagation delay. T setup is called the setup time and T hold is called the hold time, correct? And there are propagation delay for the gates also, such as XOR gate has the propagation delay of 2 nanoseconds, and this particular AND gate has the propagation delay of 2 nanoseconds, correct? Similarly, the second flip-flop has the propagation delay, setup time and hold times. So we are expected to compute the maximum clock frequency. We are expected to compute the maximum clock frequency at which the given circuit can operate reliably, correct? So let's see. So for any circuit, for any sequential circuit, we have to identify what is the total propagation delay that comes here. So let's take first flip-flop one, okay? So I'm taking flip-flop one. So you can say this is your flip-flop one. Correct, and this is your flip-flop two, right? So in flip-flop one, if I have to compute the total delay, right, at which it operates is, so flip-flop one, if you have to see here, is this is the input and this is the output, correct? This is the input and this is the output here. So if you compute the total delay T at a flip-flop one, so you can say T flip-flop one, which would be, so to produce the output for flip-flop one, it has to wait for the input which is coming from flip-flop two first, right? So let's say flip-flop two produces the output, but it takes 8 milliseconds to propagate from flip-flop two to flip-flop one, right? So for flip-flop one, it has to wait for 8 milliseconds or 8 nanoseconds for flip-flop one. To produce the output, it has to wait for 8 nanoseconds in which it receives the output, in which it receives the inputs from flip-flop number two, correct? So this 8 nanosecond would be here. That's your delay, correct? That's your delay. So that I have taken, correct? Plus, once flip-flop one receives this input from flip-flop two, it takes 5 nanoseconds in setting up its own environment. I repeat, once it receives the input from flip-flop two, once it receives the input from flip-flop two, it takes 5 nanoseconds to establish its own setup, right? So you can see that 5 nanoseconds is getting added here, right? Is added here. Now, whole time we have taken 0 nanoseconds here. So you can see flip-flop one eventually will take total of 13 nanoseconds time to produce the output, in which 8 nanoseconds is the delay through which it receives the input from flip-flop 2, and 5 nanoseconds is its own setup time, correct? So that's first. Now let's take flip-flop 2. In order to produce the output for flip-flop 2, it takes, what is the total time here? First, this input to the flip-flop two is coming from the gates, correct? So this gates, the XOR gate, time taken in the XOR gate is 2 nanoseconds. After that, time taken by that particular NAND gate is another 2 nanoseconds. Okay, plus it has to wait to receive the input from this flip-flop also, correct? So another 3 nanoseconds of delay coming from flip-flop one, another 3 nanoseconds of delay because of the flip-flop one, correct? So 3 nanoseconds plus 2 nanoseconds plus 2 nanoseconds, this input would reach here. After that much of time, once it reaches there, flip-flop 2 has its own setup time. Once it reaches there, flip-flop 2 has its own setup time, which is of 4 nanoseconds. So total comes is 2 plus 2, 4 plus 3, 7 plus 11, right? So 11 nanoseconds will be taken by flip-flop 2 to produce the outcome, right? Again, I repeat, correct? So for flip-flop 2, it has to wait for the inputs which are coming from the gate. So this XOR and NAND gate takes two milliseconds. So here, this is for XOR, 2 nanoseconds. This is for NAND, 2 nanoseconds. Also, this is connected with flip-flop 1. So once a flip-flop 1 produces the output, it takes 3 nanoseconds to get it propagated from flip-flop to this XOR. So 3 nanoseconds would be added as a propagation delay from flip-flop 1 to the XOR. Now, once the input reaches a D flip-flop, it has its own setup time, which is of 4 nanoseconds. So total comes 2 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, which is at 11 nanoseconds, correct? So total delay for flip-flop 2 is 11 nanoseconds. Now, we have to decide our clock frequency intelligently so that it can match up with this, correct? So here we can see always we have to operate at the largest possible time so that we do not face any trouble here. So here you can see this is 11 nanoseconds, this is 13 nanoseconds. So I set up my clock, let's say t greater than or equals to 13 nanoseconds, which will make reliable operation for this entire circuit, correct? Since I know that f, which is frequency, is nothing but 1 by t. So I can write it down in this way, 1 divided by 13 into 10 power minus 9, correct? Into 10 power minus 9, which comes to 76.92 megahertz. So I can operate, right? So I can operate. So here you can see this should go less than or equals to so that I can operate at max frequency of this, correct? So I can operate at, let's say, F less than or equals to 76.92 megahertz, correct? Less than or equals to 76.92 megahertz. Now here, what is it asking? Asking us to find out the maximum clock frequency at which the circuit can operate reliably, correct? So this gives me a clear cut F max, the frequency, maximum frequency at which the circuit operates reliably, which is nothing but 76.92 megahertz, correct? That would be our final answer here, 76.92 megahertz, okay? If you have any questions, please feel free to drop in the comment box or reach me out. We'll address them. Thank you very much.